Why did you come here, and what did you hope to find here? And
yeah, I hope to know how to connect Joomla with any software on the computer.
Yeah.
So on the computer, you said it says web services. I expected it was with other website thing you can be with. Like, I don't know what you're going to do.
You know what web services are now?
What do you mean by web services now?
Control. Oh. Okay. So I'm Herman Peer. I'm from Holland. And I'm a software developer for a very long time, but not so very long with Joomla. So I've been around in other areas, and that's maybe also one of the things why I do this this subject, to connect Joomla with the rest of the world, with other programs, with other things. So it's that should be the 2nd of June. So there must be probably or not first today. Okay.
Everything is good.
Oh, except for the connection. To go to the next slide, you have to insert it here. Sorry for the inconvenience.
It's a metaphor for your talk.
Yeah. So when this thing has to make a connection first.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Yes. A web service is data exchange with a web server. So you know a web server, normally you go to a web server, you with your browser, you get a web page. And look, customer number 3. Yes, just now. Now.
Nobody knows where your session is.
Oh, are there more people?
Start now. Yes, just
start now. Okay, can I tell some guys that we are here?
Okay, thank you very much. Then we will just wait a little bit more.
You can only say it twice.
Yeah, I can say it twice. That's all right. So, and then I can first now repeat a bit, and then when the people rehearse a bit, and then when they come, oh, there they are. Okay. Look. Sorry, it was a bit unclear where everything is, and the schedule of yesterday was there. Could you please come a bit? You can always leave Sneaky there. It's no problem. I just started to say what is a web service. A web service is data exchange with a web service is data exchange with a web server, and it is often in XML format. So you have some web server, and it gives some XML data, often in XML, but could be in JSON, could be in anything, as we see later, but originally often in XML. And you have a database behind, and this application could be another web application, could be a desktop application, could be any application. I haven't seen the slides for some days too myself, so I wonder what will come. I didn't rehearse it those last days. Okay. There are more ways to connect to data that are on the server. For instance, we had last year, we had someone with an Access database and a Joomla website. And in the Access database that was used on the desktop, they had a whole application that was used for running the whole office. And there was a website, it was for an association of therapists. And they could renew their name on the Joomla extension we made there, and But in the office, they wanted to have that data synchronized. And the first thing I thought about was a web service, because a web service is normally used for that kind of data exchange. But just as an alternative, there are always many more roads that lead to Rome. And this was, in this case, used as an alternative. We didn't go via the access to the web server with a web service, for instance, and then exchange the data with the database and put it back to access, but we went directly to the database, and that is was now done with an ODBC connection. That is not possible with every provider, but it gives very nice possibilities to directly connect. But yeah, the programming had to be done in Visual Basic in this case. And well, if you want to stick to PHP, you better do a web service. And so now, web services. What I said, data exchange mainly by XML. You see, for instance, here that a client here could be a desktop program or another or in a browser or whatever, goes to a web server, and that web server connects here with all kind of other web services. For instance, this is for booking a travel. And if you want to book the travel, you want to here book the hotel, you want to book the car, maybe you want to book some trips, all those things are done from one computer asking another computer, is that possible, and aggregating all the data and getting back to the client. So that's trying to get the web more, not only that we are looking in Google, I want to search this, but to get more applications that are working together on the whole web that could exchange data, aggregate data, and this is more in the direction also of a more semantic web, etc. So this is also nowadays web services are mostly used one-to-one, but this is more a future thing also. Well, things like this are being used now. Now, at this moment, if you use Joomla, you use a CMS. It's just Joomla with a back end and a front end, and you have a website, and it's not connected to anything. And you could connect Joomla to other things, so making some connections to it, different kind of connections, then you could just plug in maybe some other services that are there in the cloud, to call another many used buzzword. So you could, for instance, connect to desktop applications, rich internet applications. You could connect to Java, to Flex, maybe Delphi, Visual Studio, Titanium, Microsoft Office, like I just said, the example of an Access database or database application it was. And but you could also connect to other web applications. For instance, to another Joomla site, or to another, to anything. And you could connect to it as a server or as a client, I say. Web services is always a server-client model. So you have the ones who provide the data, and the ones who consume the web services, as it is called. You can also consume web services in a browser. That's called Ajax. So that's in fact Ajax is using a web service, only it's another buzzword that's put on it. And it's not often when people talk about web services, they mean just some other program who connects to a web server. But also from a browser, if you go to the web server and get some data, and you get it back in XML or JSON or whatever, because that's also so funny. You see, the Ajax originally was asynchronous JavaScript and XML. And nowadays, often Ajax is used not only asynchronous but also synchronous, often without Javan, not necessarily with JavaScript. It's most often even used with JSON nowadays and not with XML. So it's more a name now, and that's also why they then write it in, not in capital anymore nowadays. If you just write AJAX, so that's a abbreviation, and nowadays it's more a technique of from the browser go to a website server, get some data, and put them in your web page. You can do the same with Flash, of course. In Flash, you can have a language ActionScript, and you can go to the web server, say, give me those data, and works very nice. But you can go to any other program or whatever. Example uses in Joomla. You could, for instance, you all know Akiba, the Joomla pack, and Akiba also has a remote control. Have you ever used that? Yeah, I use it often, but then you are on Windows too, because Akiba remote control is made with Delphi. How do you say? How would you pronounce it? Anyway. With a desktop program written in this case in Delphi, and so for and you can say for you can say I have 100 websites, and I want them all to have backup. Push the button, and they go. The remote control does all the things you want to do, and Akiba remote uses XML RPC. As a protocol, we'll see that later, but just for now. You could use some external services, like for instance Google Docs or Amazon S3 for storage, etc. There's so many things that have an API and that you can use via a web service. And those web services can be used in a website, but in any other program. That's so nice. That's what I like. You can connect anything to anything. And also in bridges with other applications. So there was here a demonstration of MageBridge that uses the XML RPC connection with Magento to connect it with Joomla. But Magento also has a SOAP. A web service, you have different sorts of web services, we'll see that later. Here are those things I sometimes already said, XML, RPC, SOAP, REST, things like that. When we talk about web services, we mostly have it about one of those three ways to input and output three protocols to use web services. But you could use any format for the exchange of data with a web server. Often in Ajax, you just define yourself, you make an Ajax application, you make in Joomla, you make a component that outputs some XML or JSON, mostly JSON then, I think. And But how you define the variables that you use in that in the data that you exchange, you mostly make up yourself. You don't have somewhere that written down for, now I use an integer with and it means this, and you do that with it. That might be in your documentation. Often it is not, but because you just use it yourself, and you recognize that. Yeah. And you could also use a binary protocol like AMF that is used by Adobe for data exchange with Flash. In Joomla you have a standard AMF PHP to exchange data from Flash with a web server. And that's just another protocol, so then it's not done via XML or RPC, SOAP or REST, but just another binary protocol by Adobe, or now it's now from Adobe, and you can use that to exchange data with Flash. I did a presentation some years ago, last year, at the Dutch Joomla Day about using XML for data exchange with Flash. For I think it's better to use more widely used protocols and not their own protocol. But well, every advantage has its disadvantages, as a famous soccer player from Holland would say. Here are some examples of web services that are there in the cloud that you could use. So for instance, you see here from Flickr, you see they have several formats, several protocols they use when you try to when you connect to it. So you can connect via REST, you can connect via XML RPC, you can connect via SOAP, and you can get it back in diverse response formats. And that's all, you just click on it, you get a good description of it, and it's not so difficult to implement. And then you can, when you build an extension, for instance, in Joomla, but also when you would use it in any other program, you can just connect via those protocols, and or you make an iPhone app or whatever. And so you can update your Flickr things, or use it in a website, or do whatever you want with it. And you see here in the YouTube, they use REST as a protocol, and we'll see that later a bit more, that REST uses or HTTP GET or HTTP POST or PUT or DELETE, and so, that's a different way to do, but we'll see that later. Here are some other examples. So you see Yahoo Search API, you can just use that in your own website, or Google weather information, or all kind of things. You see that they use REST, and here the Amazon S3, they use REST or SOAP. And this is also a URL that could be handy. It's programmableweb.com. It started by people who were working on REST, and they want to. There are a lot of APIs defined there, and you can click on it further for more information. And it's a wealth of information where you can go to, where you can connect to hundreds of things you can find. There's one big, from the three things we saw, XML, RPC, SOAP, and REST, is one big, difference. You can have remote procedure calls, or you can have REST. And remote procedure calls, an example of that is the first two protocols, as I said, that's XML, RPC, and SOAP. What you do is you call a method on the server. So you have in your program, you want to use, you want to call a method, for instance, give me the weather in Wiesbaden at that and that day, and you get a weather forecast back in an XML format or something like that, with a Google Weather, for instance. And so you just call a method on the server. You let the server do something. Most examples of XML RPC, for instance, with the Akiba, it's a call, hello, make me a backup. And then you can do a call, hello, send me the backup zipped to my hard disk, etc. In REST, does anybody here use web services, or is it? So you're a bit familiar with this. So it's a bit difficult if you want to explain that in a short time to everybody. If you haven't seen it yet, and if you have seen it, I don't have to explain it so very much. So it's a bit. That's yeah, huh? Yeah, that's all right. If anyone has a question, please do.
I use one of the services that declares itself as REST, but they actually do the first type of the operations. So you call, give me hotel pictures, or and you put their ID and you get the XML with pictures and descriptions back. So, but they call themselves as a REST.
Yeah, that is also because it is a buzzword. REST sells better than something else. If you say I use SOAP or I use XML RPC, then they think you are very, very old-fashioned. And they want. If you say, well, I have a RESTful framework, and it's a buzzword. So it's also if it can be reached by just calling an URL, they often just already call it, it's REST. But it's not completely true that is not REST in the strict case of, in the strict sense of the word. Yeah.
I have an example here for SOAP application.
Yes.
It is an iPhone app.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is from, I think it is an American developer who did that, and he's using SOAP.
Yeah.
And XML RPC, XML RPC plugin to administer Joomla.
But is he using XML RPC or SOAP?
XML RPC.
XML RPC, yeah. That's a bit logical because Joomla. For a long time, just only use it's standard in the core in the package, so it's obvious that when you want to connect to Joomla, let's make it XML RPC. Then we don't have to think any further. There are more things done with it, and just do it. Yeah.
One big example for REST is Twitter. Okay. In one phrase, you can say you put your tweets on the REST. It's really simple. I wrote some little iPhone apps out of REST and Twitter.
Yeah,
it works really well. It's really easy.
What you see, what you see also is that REST is simpler, and so it's becoming more and more popular. SOAP was heavily promoted by Microsoft, and that it might also be one of the reasons why it's not so much implemented in Joomla, because some people have something against Microsoft. I'm everybody's friend. Some people call that very hoary or not. This is. Leave it. We go to I will show some things shortly about XML RPC, then SOAP, and then REST. In XML RPC, you have to define some I/O types. So you have to say this is an integer, this is a string, etc. Most of the time, you just define everything as a string, and you in your program you just do with it whatever you want, because all those things about types is more from, it comes forth from strongly typed languages, like in Delphi you have that, but in PHP it doesn't really matter so very much whether it's a string or an integer, etc. But it is good to type your variables so that it gives more security too.
At least on the input side.
Yeah.
Or a URL.
Yeah, and also for security, it is much better. In Joomla, we use the XML, the PHP XML RPC library. That's always included in it. In Joomla, we mostly do you call the XML RPC by writing a plugin. And that plugin, so you make a call to XML RPC, you write a plugin, and then in the plugin you do your procedure calls. It is not such a how much must I say? Normally, when you go to a Joomla site, you go to that site and. I just wanted to say that it is better to use the model view controller thing. But how do you say it? When you normally go to the Joomla site, you see it's all improvised. It's not so much rehearsed. But when you go to the Joomla site, you go to the component, and the component has the controller says, what input do I have? Okay, you need that model, you need that view, put the model and the view together, and bye-bye. And when you use XML RPC, as you use it in 1.5, you say, hello, I want to use XML RPC, and it goes to a different place, not to the normal component that you write. It goes to a plugin. In the plugin, you write the code, etc. And in Joomla 1.6, that has been changed. And I agree with that, because it should be within the model view controller model. So when some data comes in the controller, then the controller says, okay, do whatever you want to do with the data, do it in the model, and then output it in a view. When it comes from XML RPC, in fact, it could very well be done within this model, as you also do with an AJAX call, for instance. That's exactly the same. When you have an AJAX call, you just write a component. The AJAX data comes into the controller. Controller says, hey, this is some AJAX. Now, that must be done by that model and that view, and send it back to whoever asked for it. And that's also the way that in 1.6, the XML RPC is just used. You just write a component. And in the component, the controller says, hey, this is XML RPC. Okay, that will be handled by that model, etc. And the big advantage of it is that you can use exactly the same model for your XML RPC as you're using for the same component that is being used on your website. And that is the way it should be. That's why we have that model view controller, because now often when we have model view controller, it's just a burden. It should be give you reusable pieces of software. And the reusable piece here is the model. The only things that are different from using or doing something with data in a website or in a web service, the only things that are different are the input and the output. But what you do with it is exactly the same thing, and that you can do that very well with a model view controller model. Model view controller model. Yeah, now this. I said that. No plugin anymore. We have a new J controller. And yeah, for people who are into the design patterns, when I looked at it, I looked at the file structure, I already thought maybe it could be a bit better, but we'll write, we two will write about it. No, first to each other in mail, and if other people are interested in thinking about things like that, would be nice. And you get a controller name now, the name of the component .xmlrpc.php, and you, in the same way, you, when you want to ask some JSON, you get controller name .json.php, etc. And if you want to see more about it, Lewis has posted some thing about it on this Joomla docs / XMLRPC.
Is it already in 1.6?
It should be. Yeah. But if you do it with. Yeah, but
decided that we use the XML output and not the, yeah, not the HTML output.
That's right, but what they're doing in 1.6 is you're choosing a different controller depending on which protocol you're masterful, rather than choosing a different view depending on what format you're requesting.
Yeah.
It's almost the same thing.
It's almost the same. Yeah. But what I think is what we need is to make some documentation and some examples how to use it and how to use it well. And I think that is one of the first thing, at least what I'm going to work on, is it's now all a bit a story and someone says you could do this, but we have to have some practical examples and put them in the wiki. Yeah. Huh? Yeah, I do it. Promise. You're all with me. So then we come to SOAP. SOAP is another protocol. It's instead of XMLRPC, evolved from XMLRPC. It was heavily used in .NET, a framework that was released by Microsoft. And I, in my opinion, it is at the moment an open source, a kind of open source framework. But not many people don't agree with that. You could even work in .NET in Eclipse. But well, I'm in no way related to OSM, but also not to Microsoft. What is the speciality of SOAP is that you have a lot of metadata. And the metadata, that's also, you have, it's an advantage and a disadvantage at the same time. Or you could say every advantage has its disadvantages. So you, when you have only a small amount of data that you want to exchange, you get a whole bunch of things with it too, but that has advantages. There are mainly two big metadata that you get extra. That is a web service description language file. It's mostly called shortly a WSDL. And you have a SOAP envelope. A SOAP envelope is just some extra XML that is around your XML data. So you want to send over some data. You for instance, you want to have a name. You get an opening tag, name, then the name itself, and closing tag, name. And but around that's the data itself. So that's called the SOAP body. So around it is a tag body and body, and you have a SOAP header. And in the SOAP header, you can put, for instance, authentication, authorization information, etc. By the way, SOAP is not only tied to HTTP. You could use SOAP on any network protocol. For instance, post pigeons or whatever you want, but mostly it's used in HTTP, but some people who heavily advocate REST say, of course, you only use web services in HTTP, but that's not completely true. So, for instance, in Holland, we have the tax department who uses SOAP in SMTP and FTP. So it's all possible. And that's not possible with REST. You have a SOAP header, and you also have that WSDL, a description of the web service, and it's a description in XML format. Here you see an example of the of such a SOAP envelope. Say you want to, you have a remote procedure call. It's called add. You want to have two figures that are added and given back the result. And so that is asked to the server. Yeah, you never write, these are always the kind of examples you see with SOAP, but I've never seen anybody ask in real life a web server to add two figures. That's a bit strange. Yeah, it's just more to get the feel of it. So you start with it's a kind of hello world application for a SOAP thing. And you see here, you get a figure A and it's a 3, and a figure B it's 4, and you want to add those two, and that's all in the SOAP body, and you have a SOAP header. I don't know what the time is, we started a bit later, but still have.
Do you?
12?
16:10.
So okay, we have 20 minutes then. That must be all right.
Yeah, but
try to do shorter.
We started half an hour late. So.
Yeah, but.
So
yeah, you're right, but then maybe we miss some other thing. Yeah. So you see. In fact, these are the only data that are sent that could be much smaller. If you use this, you send this in JSON, you mostly do some curly brackets and 3 and some 4 and a comma and another curly bracket, and that's it. But there is a lot of information around it, and also in the header you have is obviously some identification information. And when it is sent back, you see it gives some things back and also extra information. So there is a lot around it. But that is not for nothing. Because what I think is one of the most nicest, one of the nicest things of soap is that the WSDL is used for automatic coder generation. And all that extra stuff, you don't have to program that yourself. It's all done by your soap server software. So you just say, you don't write much more code than you would do with XML RPC. You just write when that add procedure is called, then add those two figures and give back the results. But there's a whole thing that the WSDL is made and the SOAP envelope is made around it. And in your client application, there could be Flex or whatever you want, that client application, that extra information is used for automatic coded generation. And that is really, that's very nice, easy to use. You see, for instance, if you, here is a, this is a .NET web service, and it is about the zip coder web service, and you can get the distance between two zip coders, and you have a zip code to details. If you just go to the URL, you just already get for yourself in a nice format the whole. This is all done automatically. So it's, yeah.
Maybe I missed something, but Joomla only has an XML RPC server.
Yeah. That's
SOAP server.
Not yet.
Okay.
Yeah, it's coming. So but this is all generated by that SOAP server, and it would be nice if Joomla had a SOAP server that you just, like you now write a plugin or a controller for the XML RPC call, that you would just write a component for your SOAP call, and that you would get the whole stuff as of WSDL, etc., etc., and you could easily connect to Joomla from whatever you want that uses SOAP. This is, for instance, if you are in Delphi. I'm a Delphi programmer also, and I like that. And you make it's easy to make a form and an application. And if you want to use a remote procedure that is called via SOAP, you just go click new unit and go to other or something, and then here you see a WSDL importer. You click on it, you get one thing where you have to put the URL in. It's just copy paste the URL of the web service and ready. You can just call the remote procedure within your program. It makes a proxy, and that's all you have to do. And in Flex Builder, it's now this was Flex Builder 3, and now it's called Flex Builder 4. That's to make, for instance, desktop applications platform-wide, except for the iPhone and the iPad. But who cares? You see, you just fill in the URL of the WSDL, and push the button, and ready to go. You can just call that remote procedure as if it was a procedure you called just on your own computer. So in Joomla, when I looked a bit in the JET and what has been done, and I looked a bit around, let's say that, because this is 1.0. I saw there was a vBulletin connection called JM Soap. It was but it's only in use for Joomla 1.0. There is a VM SOA, that is a SOAP connection for VirtualMart. These are all SOAP as a client-side use of SOAP. So to use the other things, to use VirtualMart in Joomla, so you could use those components. But there are a lot of other PHP libraries that you can use to easily create a SOAP server. So, for instance, NewSOAP, that was a bit the standard in PHP 4 to create a SOAP service. You just said require once newsoap.php. Of course, you must include that file somewhere or put it in a library somewhere. And you just say dollar server is new SOAP server, and you have a SOAP server, and you can program that for it. It's good documented, it's all open source, no problem.
Except
That's right, that's the next thing. PHP 5, I'll leave the rest, but it's very good to look at the Zend thing. Zend has XML RPC, SOAP, and REST. Everything worked out for all kind of web services. They made clients out of the box, so you can use that, and you could use some things of Zend in Joomla. It's not so difficult to rework something that has been done in Zend to Joomla. But PHP 5 has a SOAP module, and nowadays at most providers that module is also installed. So then you can, out of the box, don't have to do anything, you can just use that SOAP module. I spoke to Rafael from Tienda. He was working on a component, it's called JSOAP. And it's coming soon, and he was working on it with NewSOAP, but also worked against the problem that if the PHP 5 SOAP is installed on your server, then you can get conflicts, and with NewSOAP, and he started working now with the PHP 5 SOAP, because so in 1.6 we all only have PHP 5, so why would you do all the trouble? And it's very easy to use, and he is working on it, and we have contact about it, and he is expecting to release that very soon, because he needs it for some things. And as I understood, it will be released totally free. And then the next thing we have to do is make an example in the wiki and document it very well. Yeah. But I think that's one of the things we miss. Why you think it's so very hard is that it is released such a component, and there's no documentation, and the developer has no time for it, and yeah, then you have to start all over again. Just, I think if we could provide some good examples, must not be too much trouble. And I thought that would be a nice task for me if I would, but I wait for JSOAP first. But starring NewSOAP is not right anymore. I made the slides last week, and I spoke to Rafael here on the on Sunday, and he said no, we're no NewSOAP anymore. It will be all PHP 5 SOAP. REST. It's what I said. It's also a buzzword, but it's also things made simpler. You saw the SOAP has the whole envelope around it, and some people said, well, why would we do all that extra trouble if all the things you do are already in HTTP? It all started with a dissertation of Mr. Roy Fielding, he made a, it's one of the people who wrote the HTTP protocol also. So he thought it was it's good for everything. So why not use it for everything? And it is more a architecture than a protocol, I say, because in XML RPC and SOAP, you say something about typing, you give a lot of more information about the web service, and in the in REST, you just give a URL to a resource, and you say with that resource, you can essentially do four things. This is the four, what is here in CRUD. That is, you can create something, you can read something, you can update something, or you can delete something. And more, yeah, with those four, you can make a whole application. When you could even make only objects, only components that only use those four methods. Any if you have an object that has 20 methods, you could also split it up into more objects that only use those four methods. So you could also use assembler language, of course. But okay, that's my. I won't say that it is only make it easier, because to rework it in such a way that everything works with only those four basic methods can sometimes make it a bit unclear, and sometimes it would even be much clearer to use SOAP or XML RPC or whatever. Well, I would prefer SOAP then. No, leave it. That they don't call a procedure remote on the server, but they just say, what's the web all about? It's that there is some data somewhere, and you want to do something with the data. That data, you give it a URL, and you just say, do something with that data. How is in the HTTP protocol, you also have an envelope around it. With HTTP headers. So you have an HTTP header GET or an HTTP header POST, we all know, but you also have an HTTP header PUT and an HTTP header DELETE, for instance, or HTTP header AUTHORIZATION, or so you have all kind of HTTP headers that are sent to the server, and you don't need extra XML for that. What REST says is use those already there methods in the HTTP headers, and it's all right. If you want to know anything about RESTful web services, I'd say read this book. You know everything. You know a lot about it. And what's also so nice is he talks about XML RPC and SOAP and how you can better use REST than the WSDL and what would be the good things of SOAP, etc. But how REST is better with that and how you do that. Those two, Leonard Richardson and Sam Ruby, it's not the same as from the Ruby language, but those two are really, it's a very nice book to read. And. Well, I look like a bookseller. I have no in my other presentation I talked about, but I'm just enthusiastic. I like a laptop, but I never go to the toilet with a laptop. But with a book I do. But you must look out with that very much, because if it's a good subject, then maybe in your head you could connect the surroundings where you are, or the things you smell, with what you read in the book. So you must be careful with this. It's a very good book, and if you read it too often on toilet, so maybe you get bad idea about it. Connected in your unconsciousness, and so.
Is that where the expression "code smells" comes from?
Code smells. Yeah, yeah. I think so. Yeah. So now in Nuku framework, you have a cake controller bread. Bread is another expression like crud. It's instead of four methods, like what I say, to create, to read, to update, and to delete. They also this is also to read, to edit. It's to update, to add is, and to delete. And you also have a browse, that's the fifth one, if you have a whole list. And they have one extra method for it. And that's also perfectly possible with REST. In Nuku, you have the bread, and the K requests can also take all the data from the what you put in, for instance, a put in the body of a put request can easily be retrieved. You can not do that out of the box in Joomla. And only the authentication and things that's being worked on, that's planned for 0.9. They're now working on almost releasing 0.7. But Jeremy Wilken is also now experimenting a lot with making his authentication in REST in the Nuku framework. In Joomla, we had on altogether as a whole some restful thoughts. It's and Mitch Pertle was also saying he had done all kind of things of about it. But when someone asked for, do you have some code? Didn't see anything. But well, it comes. I think we just have to. There are a lot of possibilities. And especially now REST is coming up so much, it would be very nice if we have a good REST API in Joomla.
Is there in fact any difference between REST and what we do with an Ajax call? I don't see the difference.
Yeah, what you do with an Ajax call is that you call a certain component. So you call a remote procedure.
A resource.
Yeah. You know, it can be. But one of the things that is essential for RESTful, to make it RESTful, is that you limit yourself to the four or five basic operations you do on that data.
Yeah. That's exactly what I do.
Yeah, if you only...
I post data.
Yeah.
Or I get data.
Yeah, if you only get data in an Ajax call, okay, yeah, that's RESTful then, yeah. But if you want to update some data or create some new data, then mostly it is not done by outputting a put HTTP header or a and then the Ajax call would be completely RESTful. But almost any GET is RESTful. So all feeds are RESTful web services in a way, but there are only one way, just only to get some data. But if you want to update and to do something more with the data, and that's mostly where the problem is. And most of the problems with web services are also in authentication, or better said, in authorization. If you see, for instance, in the remote control of Akiba, there you have some you have all kind of remote procedure calls. And in every procedure call, you have in the parameters, you have a parameter username and password. Okay, the second time it is used, they store a token in the password and leave the username empty. But essentially, you put some authorization in every procedure call. Mostly with SOAP, you store the credentials, as this username and password, or a token, or whatever you want to show that you are the one you are and that you are authorized to do the things you want to do. It is stored in a SOAP header. So in the extra XML, they store some things. And if you see books on SOAP, I don't want to sell you any of those books now, but if you see books on SOAP, you mostly see those credentials also in plain text. And what they say is, if you want to have this secure, just use SSL, a secure socket layer, so HTTPS, and then everything is all right. And some people say, yeah, but my provider doesn't, I can't use any SSL. Oh, sorry. Ooh. Yeah, we're here. Let's go to the next one. Use some SSL, no, first this. With REST, the credentials are in the HTTP headers. So you can have an authorization header and an authentication header and an authorization header, just HTTP headers. But they are used about in the same way as the SOAP headers, only in the, there are some more worked out protocols already for that you don't have to send the plain text. This, so you could use HTTPS to encrypt everything you send over the line. This is a good protocol to send. If you ever go to your banking account via internet, use HTTPS, and you can exchange all kind of things. And nobody who is on the same line can see your username, password, etc. You could define some encryption yourself. You could use Base64. There's essentially, when you encrypt yourself, there are two kinds of encryptions. One is that it is two-way, it can be decrypted too. And the other one is, it's a one-way encryption. It's a hash, it's like MD5. You can only, if you want to see if someone has this, now in Joomla has a right password, you encrypt it in MD5 with a salt, and you look if that's the same what is in the database, but you can't decrypt the Joomla password that is in the database. In a web service or in a login or whatever, there's not so much difference with it. That's what I wanted to say. So, at the end, I think it's a good idea to get Joomla connected to other sites. And what you see now is, for instance, you have that mage bridge that says, yeah, we can connect to Magento from Joomla. But I would like to see it that we make Joomla that good, that people say, yeah, I could connect to Joomla from my application. That would even be nicer if we could connect it, all kind of things, or we could use web services very easy, etc. So I'd say let's provide some good XML, RPC, SOAP, and REST within the MVC framework in a uniform form way. Yeah, my example bit is how they have done it in Zend. I like that very much. It's very, very neat, but you don't want to we want to have it better, I think. But first we must do it, and so we can connect Joomla more easily to other programs. So let's get it connected. That's it. Questions?
Do you also have code for other languages? For example, you mentioned Delphi.
I'm writing in Delphi, and I use SOAP services for a lot. And there's the, in Delphi, a guy, an Italian.
XML RPC.
Yeah, you can see that in Akiba Remote Control, what Nicholas Dionysopoulos has written. That's XML RPC, and it's very nicely written. It's all in Delphi, and only Delphi is not. It's only compiling now to Windows, so you can only see that in Windows. But Nicholas wants to have his remote control on the Mac and Linux too. He has tried with Lazarus, that's the free, the open source version of Delphi. You can compile with that to the Mac and to Linux, but it has some problems. It's improving now, and next month we have Lazarus, that's the free Pascal movement. We have a big gathering in Utrecht in Holland. But I saw a roadmap from 2 weeks ago from Delphi, and the first thing on top of the roadmap is to compile Delphi programs for the Mac. It's a very strange roadmap. It's a roadmap without any date on it. And on the bottom it says, don't count on it. So it's more good wishes. Yeah, we all want that. So it might more be a selling trick than... But Nicholas is not going to wait for that. And he is now using Titanium. He put me on that track. I had never used it. And Titanium is very new. It's open source. And you can use PHP and JavaScript to make desktop applications. And great, have a look at it. Titanium. It's Nicholas has been using it, and he's rewriting the remote control now and busy with it. And I took a look at it. Of course, it's a bit slower than when you use a native application, completely native, and also has some problems with threads. In PHP, you can't have multi-threading, which is easy in Delphi. So every advantage has disadvantages. But of course, my aim with those web services is also to provide good examples. And then, of course, we must have a good example in Delphi, in Flex, and all those things to show what is possible.